Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 23385 in the name of Ross Greer on safe schools. Can I invite all members who wish to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now? And I call on Ross Greer to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I move the motion in my name. I know I can speak on behalf of all of us when I say thank you to every teacher, every member of school staff, every pupil, parent and carer for their efforts over the last 8 months. Our young people's education has unquestionably been damaged, but disruptions and closures have far wider impacts on their mental health, social development, and for some, losing the stability and security of school has been a direct risk to their health and their well-being. But the decisions made here can't be binary choices between total closure and just pretending that schools can go back to normal. Everyone in our schools, staff and pupil, deserves a safe environment. The Greens have brought these proposals to Parliament today because that is simply not the case across Scotland. It's clear that schools are struggling. Several have had to partially close already, like Aboyne Primary and Milnes High in this past week. And whilst I don't believe there's a significant gulf between the government and opposition parties on these issues, I have to be blunt with the Education Secretary and say that the description he and other ministers have given of life in our schools in recent days just does not match the reality as described by hundreds of teachers. The specific issue I want to start with is one that I raised with genuine regret. I can no longer totally believe the official statistics on self-isolation and transmission within our schools. That's not something that I say lightly, but let me explain why, based on what school staff have been telling me. Multiple teachers have described being prevented by senior managers from fully listing the number of their pupils considered close contacts because the school want to keep self-isolation numbers low. In one case, a teacher who tested positive themselves listed their whole primary class as close contacts following the guidance. They were told they could pick no more than a third of the children in the class. In other cases, teachers were not consulted at all when one of their pupils tested positive and were unable to identify either themselves or other pupils as close contacts. A number reported pupils who weren't asked to isolate subsequently becoming ill. One teacher told me that pupils at their school who were identified in the morning were told to attend class for the rest of the day and not to tell their teachers that they had been confirmed as a close contact. In some cases, it appears that this is due to rigid systems of deciding close contacts based on limited information, like fixed seating plans. In others, it's a case of schools fearing parental backlash if they ask large numbers of pupils to isolate, or if they do so in the middle of the day when a parent would need to come and collect them. And in a number of instances where staff themselves should be isolating but have been prevented from doing so, it's because the school is worried about staffing pressures. One consistent theme on Track and Trace was teachers feeling that they or their school were doing it alone, without support from or connection to local public health teams and the wider Track and Trace system. I'm not here to tell the Education Secretary why that's the case, but I am telling him that it's happening, and I urge the government to urgently review whether Track and Trace is working in schools. And they should do so by speaking directly to the overworked teachers who are having to take on the role of public health officials on top of delivering in-person and remote learning. Because if councils and school management are telling Mr. Swinney that this system is working, I really must urge him to hear the reality from the front lines. Across the country, over 2,500 school staff are off due to COVID, alongside roughly 26,000 pupils. But from what I've been told, this is an undercount. Pupils and staff who should be isolating are not, and it's driving transmission. And in at least one case, teachers have told me of their school marking some self-isolating pupils as being absent for other reasons. I don't understand why, but it is happening, and the correspondence I'm getting is too widespread and too consistent to write off as isolated incidents. We're all aware that teachers in a number of areas were told to switch off the Protect Scotland app, even when their phone is with them all day. Multiple members of staff have reported to me they've even been told to ignore notifications from the app to self-isolate if they think they were sufficiently protected. Given that the app doesn't tell you who you came into close contact with, this is a frankly dangerous suggestion. And I would urge the government to review every council's guidance, which in at least one case suggests that staff don't need to self-isolate if they were wearing a mask while in close contact with a positive case. I can find nothing in the Scottish Government's own guidance or clinical advice to support this, and the equivalent guidance in England suggests, correctly, the opposite. This motion calls for urgent action to protect vulnerable teachers in particular. I'm aware that at least 1,000 teachers have had requests to work from home rejected in recent weeks. And following his invitation, I've raised two constituents' cases with the Education Secretary in the last couple of days. It's quite clear that a number of councils are insisting that extremely vulnerable teachers and other staff continue to teach in classrooms or to use up their sick leave entitlement. I've been contacted by teachers with vastly reduced lung capacity due to conditions like cystic fibrosis, with chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, with heart conditions and severe asthma. They were all previously shielding. All of their GPs recommended they work from home, as of specialists, occupational health officials and others. Every one of their requests were rejected. These are teachers terrified, with justification, that going to work right now could kill them. In an increasing number of cases, the behaviour of their employers has escalated to bullying and unions are now involved. The government must act to ensure that clinically vulnerable staff are supported. That means ensuring that they can work from home or in a safer alternative environment. Where that isn't possible, they should be supported to go on leave without loss of income. And I would urge the Education Secretary to immediately clarify the guidance for previously shielding staff in level 4 areas. The First Minister announced yesterday that shielding pupils should not attend school in person in those areas, but a number of staff got in touch with me immediately as a result to ask about circumstances for them. Some councils have been quite open about the reason why they're preventing staff from working from home or self-isolating, that there aren't enough other staff available to keep schools open. Not only is this grossly irresponsible towards those who are clinically vulnerable, who frankly feel like it's been decided that they're expendable, it is short-sighted and dangerous when it simply leads to infectious individuals staying in school and transmitting the virus. The EIS wrote to the First Minister over the summer calling for 3,500 additional teachers to reduce class sizes and thus increase social distancing. Around 1,400 posts were funded and recruited. Thus, the motion calls for an additional 2,000 teachers to be urgently recruited. Given staff absence rates already, before flu season begins, additional staff will be critical to simply keeping schools open, never mind reducing class sizes. The final proposal in this motion is for regular testing to be available to all staff and senior pupils. At present, this isn't available to asymptomatic pupils, and staff must actively seek it out. That simply isn't delivering the scale of testing which we know from international evidence can be effective. Presiding officer, vulnerable teachers and support staff across the country are watching this debate, expecting that Parliament will step up to protect them this winter. I hope colleagues will agree that between this motion and the opposition amendments, we're able to do so. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on John Swinney to speak to and move Amendment 23385.3.
Presiding officer, I welcome this debate and I move the amendment in my name. I wholeheartedly agree with the point in the motion that education is best delivered in the classroom. And I also agree that keeping our schools safe for pupils, teachers and staff must remain a central priority for us all. Ensuring this has been the key consideration in the work of the Education Recovery Group that has drawn together government, local authorities, professional associations, parents' groups and education advisers. The original guidance in August, supplemented by further measures, was designed to ensure that we are doing all that we can to keep schools safe. I confirmed to Parliament my clear commitment to continue with that approach. One of my priorities has been to ensure there is high-quality information available that can inform debate and provide assurance to all concerned. The Advisory Subgroup on Education and Children's Issues today published an updated evidence paper on many of these questions in relation to school safety and to the prevalence of the virus within schools. And Public Health Scotland have published new summary statistics which provide extensive detail on this issue. The evidence shows no difference between the positivity rates of preschool, primary and secondary school teachers and staff relative to other worker groups of a similar age. This is a finding that I hope provides reassurance that schools, with the right protective measures in place, which are required by the guidance that was set out in August and updated in October, are safe places to be for children and for staff. In addressing the risks of children and young people being in school, the reports make clear that children and younger people are much less susceptible to severe clinical disease arising out of coronavirus, that there is no direct evidence that transmission within schools plays a significant contributory role in rates of infection amongst children, and time out of school, and that time out of school has a detrimental effect, particularly for vulnerable children. The evidence weighs clearly in favour of children attending school whenever it is safe to do so, and that is why the Government has made this a priority. I'll give way to Mr Greer.
Ross Greer.
Thank you, and I thank the Education Secretary for giving way. On the point of data suggesting that there's not significant transmission between pupils and schools, could the Education Secretary respond to the points I've raised where schools are simply not reporting this, where there's a potential undercount because schools are instructing teachers not to identify pupils as close contacts of those who have tested positive? Some of those pupils are falling ill as a result of that.
John Swinney.
Well, the point I was making there was about the evidence that emerges from the PCR testing that is undertaken on children. And that is, I think that is indisputable evidence in relation to the way in which the testing regime operates and what it indicates about the prevalence of COVID amongst children. And therefore, as a consequence, the transmissibility of that to other children within a school context. Pupil attendance data shows that just 1.2% of total absences are due to COVID-19 related sickness. This represents just 0.1% of all pupils. The rate of COVID related sickness amongst pupils is low across the country, including in the 11 local authorities that will move into level 4 on Friday. This data, alongside the fact that the proportion of positive test cases from people aged 18 plus who reported an occupation in education and childcare, has remained largely constant since late August. This helps to demonstrate why it remains safe to keep schools open in level 4, except where public health advice relevant to a specific school dictates otherwise, as is the current provision within law. The rise in overall COVID-related absences has been substantially driven by pupils who are isolating, which demonstrates that caution is being applied in the application of the self-isolation requirements within schools. My amendment, Presiding Officer, explicitly recognises, and I think it is important, that Parliament explicitly supports this and puts this on the record, the extraordinary efforts being made by councils and school staff to keep schools safe. I do not for a moment underestimate the challenge that represents to individual schools and to school leaders. Indeed, I spoke to school leaders this morning around the country about this very question. I would like to take this opportunity, and it's implicit in my amendment today, to place on record once again my deep gratitude for the dedication shown by school leaders, teachers and support staff over the past few months, because they have frankly rescued many children in our country who are better served by being in school than not being in school. Presiding Officer, our updated school guidance was published on the 30th of October. It sets out detailed guidance on most of the issues covered by the motion, including on clinically vulnerable staff, where it makes it clear that councils should take clinical advice fully into account when agreeing appropriate mitigations with employees and whether it is appropriate for employees to remain in school. On testing, we have already put in place arrangements to allow members of school staff who are concerned to get a test whether or not they have symptoms. In line with my amendment, we will bring forward plans in the near term informed by clinical advice to build on this, potentially including piloting and rolling out in-school rapid testing of staff. We will bring more detail on those plans to Parliament in the coming weeks. And the Health Secretary, of course, has a statement to Parliament on this question. Our guidance is backed by an investment of £135 million for local authorities. That includes £80 million for additional staff, and councils have already recruited 1,250 additional teachers and 155 support staff, with an estimated 200 further teachers and 100 support staff in the pipeline. This is, of course, in addition to the normal capability of local authorities to be able to recruit supply staff to provide any replacement cover that is required. Presiding Officer, the final point I wish to make is this. We cannot look at schools in isolation from the rest of society. The approach we set out in our strategic framework is designed to drive down overall virus levels. In effect, we are asking wider Scottish society to shoulder a greater burden of restrictions so that we can prioritise Scotland's children and keep their schools open. That is the choice that we have made. None of this, however, discounts the understandable anxiety felt by school staff. Where there is a need to take further action, either by updating our guidance or ensuring it is being given practical effect, we will work with partners to do so. We want schools to be safe, and we want teachers and staff to feel safe. I am committed to achieving both.
Thank you. I now call on Jamie Green to speak to and move Amendment 23385.2.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Ross Grier for using his party's time to bring this debate forward? I know we disagree on many things, but in education we have a shared passion to get it right for every child, but not just every child, every teacher too. The whole issue of keeping schools open, I think, is one of the most challenging conundrums that all governments have faced. It's also one of the most divisive, because on one side there are those who advocate complete closure and a move to online learning, and on the other are those who demand that schools must stay open at all costs. But the opening line of the motion sums up this debate perfectly, because it says that the best place for learning is in the classroom, but those classrooms must be safe for everyone. Teachers and school staff, we know, have truly risen to the challenge, doing what they love most, teaching, and teaching face-to-face where possible. But 8 months into this pandemic, the very fact that teachers are even talking about strikes should ring loud alarm bells. Now, my views on school strikes are no secret. I think they're unnecessary, I think they're damaging for pupils, and they should be ruled out. But too often, teachers' concerns have been ignored. If it is true that teachers have been asked to turn off the Protect Scotland app, if it is true that they've been asked to come to school against explicit medical advice, then that's simply not on. One teacher told me yesterday that pupils in her class were repeatedly allowed to continue classes until the end of the day, despite being contacted by Trace and Protect. That is not on either. The government has a duty to step up and make schools safe, and it's not good enough to say that that is only the responsibility of local councils, because local councils have used up all their attainment funding money to make schools safe, which begs the question now how on earth they're going to tackle attainment. And the government's amendment, I've only got 4 minutes, I'm terribly sorry, but you'll have time in closing. The government's amendment, I'm afraid, typifies its intransigent approach to any form of critique in this crisis. It implies that criticism of the government is somehow criticising those on the front line. It could not be further from the truth, which is why I support this motion and all the opposition amendments. And the government's disappointing attempts to delete the bulk of our concerns today is a telltale sign of its default position. Entrenched defence, not one that's ready to listen or ready to act. Yes, more teachers are welcome, but we call for at least 3,000 new teachers to alleviate the stresses and strains in the classroom. We also called for a national tutoring scheme similar to the one in other parts of the UK. We didn't call on it for the sake of it, but because so many have fallen far behind, despite the best efforts of parents and teachers. And there are people out there who can and will help. We've also called for greater infrastructure to bridge the digital divide to ensure that no pupil is left behind. We know that the percentage of pupils off school for COVID-related reasons in our most deprived areas is double that of our least deprived. Why is that? And what will be done about it? Because figures also show that the amount of pupils absent from school for more than half of the time has increased by nearly a fifth in just 2 years. And that was before COVID. They're not just absent from school, they're absent from learning. GERFEC means absolutely nothing if there are young people sitting at home sharing a laptop with their siblings or their parents and not engaging fully in the learning process. The online and home learning provision in some parts of this country was described by Lindsay Paterson as depressing. That is an understatement. It's not the language I would necessarily use, but he's right. It has been variable and for some just non-existent, depending who you ask. That inability to learn online will not just exacerbate social divides, but it will do nothing, absolutely nothing, to reach that holy grail of education, closing the divide. In closing, in the short time I have, if some teachers do feel pressured to go to work when they have serious underlying health conditions, we need more teachers. Simple as that. We knew that months ago, but where is the army of newly and recently qualified teachers, of classroom assistants, of teachers in retirement? How many were contacted? How many are on standby, backfilling those absences? I suspect the answer is not enough. The government needs to get its head out of the sand on this. Let's keep our schools open, but keep them safe. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Ian Gray to speak to and move amendment 23385.1.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I rise to support the motion, move the amendment in my name, and to associate myself with the remarks made by others, especially Ross Grier and the Deputy First Minister, with regard to the efforts of local authorities, teachers and indeed pupils over recent months. Yesterday, the First Minister made two things very, very clear. Firstly, that she is willing to impose severe restrictions on life in general to reduce levels of infection. And secondly, that she is determined to keep schools open even in those circumstances. She was at pains to say that these were difficult decisions for her, but she has to understand that they are difficult decisions for the public to accept and understand as well. No one wants to see young people's education interrupted again as it was earlier this year. And indeed, the motion before us does accept the objective of keeping schools open. However, people see that many young people's schooling is being disrupted by periods, sometimes consecutive periods of self-isolation, or by the absence of teaching staff. And they hear the Deputy First Minister say that there is little infection happening in schools. They hear him say that a teacher has no more chance of infection than anyone else in their community. But they do find it hard to believe. And today's paper of evidence, which the Deputy First Minister referred to, is very much a step in the right direction of sharing the evidence that underpins those assertions. But it has to happen more regularly and more transparently, and not just occasionally when a parliamentary debate demands it. Secondly, every possible material.
John Smith. I'm grateful to Mr. Gray for giving me. I want to make it explicitly clear that those papers were prepared because, for the sake of informing the debate, not because this debate was happening. These were pre-scheduled statistics to be issued.
Ian Gray.
I take that point and accept it absolutely, but the point I would make is that concerns about whether schools should remain open are not new, and so it would have been helpful if they had been planned earlier than this. Secondly, every possible mitigation must be put in place to make our schools as safe as possible. We were promised smaller class sizes and additional cleaning, yet all the evidence is that class sizes have not changed, and though additional teachers have been recruited, unions and local authorities are clear that it is not enough to reduce class sizes or indeed support the blended learning required for pupils who are self-isolating. For example, as far as we know, none of the retired teachers who responded to the GTCS is willing to step up have actually been asked to do so. And similarly, we need to see all councils, not just some, employing additional cleaning staff, going beyond extensions of hours of existing staff to provide the additional cleaning required. And we also need to look to other countries to see what else perhaps we could do. For example, to Germany, where the government is investing €500 million in enhanced ventilation in public buildings, including schools. It can't be right that all we can do is suggest keeping the windows open in the middle of a Scottish winter. Thirdly, there can be no compromise on the measures that we do indeed have in place. Teachers must not be told that they should turn off the Test and Trace app that everyone else is encouraged to use. And teachers who should be shielding should be supported and encouraged to work from home, not pressured into going into school. And finally, promises on routine, regular, asymptomatic testing must be delivered and now, not just promised, not caveated or piloted, but universally implemented by now, 8 months into this pandemic. This should be the foundation of teachers' confidence in their own safety as they go about their critical work. So the desirability of keeping schools open is not being debated here today. But what is being debated is that the government has to do much better and can do much better on transparency, on mitigation, on resources, and critically on testing to make keeping those schools open possible.
Thank you very much. I now call on Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I too want to echo what others have said about the hard work of teachers, pupils and local authorities in these recent challenging months. I'm pleased that Safe Schools has been chosen as the subject of debate today. As Ross Greer knows, I've been calling for these issues to be addressed for some time. There are many difficult realities in this pandemic and none of this is easy. Many plans have had to change and there are risks in the world that just didn't exist a year ago, but risks that people need to be shielded from. I've been astonished at the blunt dismissal that some teachers have received in response to legitimate and serious safety concerns. It's welcome that schools have been open since August. School is so important for young people's long-term well-being, and nobody wants to see their doors shut again. Some young people have already faced repeated periods of self-isolation, and it's entirely possible they will face more still as the academic year goes on. That will impact their ability to develop their learning and cover the coursework needed in any exams, and this must be at the forefront of government thinking. But while schools are open, it's essential that teachers and school support staff are treated with the dignity and respect that they deserve. Forcing vulnerable teachers to expose themselves and their families to needless danger simply because their roles are normally frontline is not an acceptable policy in any circumstance. One teacher shared the response she received from her local authority. They said, and I quote, "Teaching is a frontline role. We need teachers to lead learning with children. We are not able to provide full-time teaching roles from home." What then should a teacher concerned about their health do? Suck it up? Stay home without pay? Or worse still, find another career altogether? That's not good enough. Nobody should have to choose between their health security and their job security. This is all the more frustrating because I and others have been sounding the alarm about this for months. In October, I wrote to the Cabinet Secretary to ask for improvements to be made. I suggested that he import the framework used in Denmark, where schools have to follow the doctor's orders on working arrangements. I'm grateful to Ross Grier for including that in the motion today, and look forward to hearing what the Cabinet has Secretary has to say about that option, as I've yet to receive a response to my letter. Since then, statistics show that risk levels have gone up, but at the same time, teachers' trust in the government's handling of this has gone down. And I'm not the only one who has been asking for the Cabinet Secretary to address this. TESS reported that a group of 300 clinically vulnerable teachers wrote to the Education Recovery Group to ask for clear and consistent guidelines across all regions. They wrote, "In some cases, medical advice to remain working from home has been overruled by HR/head teachers, whilst in other regions, working from home agreements have been reached. Why is there not a consistent approach offered to all staff? Why would medical recommendations be overruled by non-medically qualified people?" I hope that the Cabinet Secretary can answer those questions today. Fair treatment needs to be Scotland-wide. Since August, many have felt that they are just being expected to get on with it. They've been telling the government that the guidance doesn't reflect the realities of teaching. The Cabinet Secretary needs to listen to what teachers are telling him. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate, and I call Patrick Harvey to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like many other members, I represent constituents who will be moved into level 4 restrictions from Friday. The prevalence of COVID within Glasgow remains, as the First Minister has said, stubbornly high. And that's having an impact on our schools as well as in the wider community. School absences are widespread, both of staff and of pupils. Last week, there were hundreds of children absent due to COVID in a single Glasgow secondary school, and most schools in the city have now been affected by positive cases. So children's learning is inevitably being disrupted, and many teachers and support staff have well-founded concerns about their own safety, as well as the safety of the wider community. It's right that we listen to them. I've heard these concerns from teachers right across Glasgow and beyond. They have reported pupils being told to attend school while awaiting test results. They have reported inconsistent approaches to other essential safety and hygiene measures. And when it comes to social distancing, every constituent who has contacted me about school safety has said quite simply that it is impossible to socially distance in full classrooms and schools, irrespective of pupil age. For medically at-risk teachers, such as those who were previously shielding, their sense of fear for their health is even greater. They're committed to their jobs. Many of them are highly experienced teachers, but their safety must not be simply set aside. Despite repeated calls for local authorities to allow home working or safer alternative working arrangements, the Director of Education at Glasgow City Council maintains that it is not possible to undertake the role of teacher at home. One medically at-risk teacher wrote to me to explain how they provided their local authority with an occupational health report, two consultant letters, and evidence from their GP saying they should work from home. But this request was refused on the basis that teachers shouldn't be working from home. Another constituent who was previously shielding said, and I quote, "I have repeatedly been told that my only option is to go on the sick. However, as I just completed my probation year with Glasgow City Council, I'm not entitled to sick pay. My options are therefore to continue working and risking my life or apply for benefits. I'm a trained teacher who is capable of working," end quote. Members of the EIS union in Glasgow are now having to consider taking collective grievances to address their health and safety concerns for pregnant and vulnerable staff. That's a situation that everybody, including the Cabinet Secretary, should find unacceptable. There are clearly questions which Glasgow City Council and other local authorities need to address, but right now they are acting in a vacuum given the absence of a clear, consistent national strategy from the government on this issue. Everybody wants to keep schools open, but the precondition for this is to keep them safe. And for that to happen, the Scottish Government must provide better guidance and more resources. I hope that that's the very clear direction given by Parliament today. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, and apologies we were not able to see Mr Harvey, but we certainly heard him. Can I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Liz Smith?
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I thank Ross Greer for securing this debate this afternoon and echo his and other members' praise for the efforts of our teachers and our school communities at this time. It is indeed a deeply worrying situation for all of us, and like Patrick Harvey, my own area is going into level four, and I have numerous correspondence from people with concerns around that. However, I do have some issues with the way things are being presented today. The Education Recovery Group is not just the government. It's the government in cooperation with COSLA, with the unions, who came up with a guidance agreed by all in order that our schools could open up and open up fully as was required. However, the implementation of that guidance and what happens in terms of the relations with the teachers is a matter for the employer, which is the local authority. If there are breaches such as being described in the chamber this afternoon, then we have to say that the guidelines are not being followed to the letter as intended, because the information is there to allow our schools to operate and continue to have a safe environment, should be, for our pupils and our teachers. This is something we've been discussing for a long time. I remember the issues around blended learning before the opening of the schools. At that point, the Conservatives were all about the parents' wishes, about the demands to get the schools open. It was the government's plans were described as a screeching U-turn. But we did what was expected at that time to get the schools open and have that face-to-face education going on wherever possible. And I have to take issue also with being absent from a school doesn't mean being absent from education. There has been a great investment in digital learning. There have been funds provided to local authorities, but it's down to individual school leaderships and the local authorities to make sure pupils have access to those digital learning opportunities. I'll take Mr. Halko Johnson.
Jimmy Halko Johnson.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. Can she tell me that she is absolutely sure that there aren't children and young people at schools missing out because they do not have the technology or the broadband required, and so they were missing out? And can she tell me how many there are? Because I've struggled to get that information from the Cabinet Secretary.
Claire.
I think, Mr. Halko Johnson, this is about local implementation. And I have examples from one local authority where one school is providing this and ensuring that that home support is there, whether digitally or not, for pupils. But in other schools, unfortunately, it is not happening. And that is a matter for the local authorities to ensure that the proper support is there for pupils that have having to self-isolate at home. And I know the Cabinet Secretary that have been concerns raised about the appropriateness of sitting exams and those considerations. And I look forward to the Cabinet Secretary explaining how multiple absences will be considered at the time of assessing an appropriateness of sitting exams. Sorry, I've already taken an intervention and I'm in my last few seconds. The fact is, 1,250 new teachers and support staff have been recruited. £80 million of support has been put in place. What we have to do is come together and work together to ensure that the guidelines and the implementation is consistent across Scotland to ensure the best outcome for our pupils.
Thank you, and I call Liz Smith to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you. When future generations come to study the COVID era, I am very certain that two things will stand out. Firstly, the extraordinarily difficult decisions which have faced all governments across the world, battling a virus about which, remarkably, despite all our modern medicine, so little was known. And secondly, the very difficult balance that has had to be struck between safeguarding health and keeping the economy and our major institutions working. Education has been right in the middle of that dilemma, schools in particular. And that dilemma is exacerbated because schools are far more than just the bricks and the mortar to house classroom learning. They are institutions which reach well beyond educational purpose and which are so vital for social well-being. They matter hugely to complement the work of parents and they matter to the pupils, a point which I think has been very well exemplified by the comments of many young people themselves, and also by their concerns over mental health when they've had to endure enforced absence from the school community. Schools bring a structure to learning, but also to extracurricular activity, which is so difficult at present, a structure to social intercourse of the school day, and a forum for all sorts of advice and guidance. So anything that we can do to ensure schools stay open is to be warmly welcomed, most especially because the medical evidence suggests that schools are places of relatively low transmission, providing all the necessary precautions are taken. Although that's definitely not necessarily the case for the future, witness today's news from five schools. Let me sympathise with teachers nonetheless. Their job is tough enough at the best of times, and I think the current pressure that they are under is in many cases hard to bear. I certainly could never agree that strike action would help. Indeed, I think that would be quite the worst message to send out to young people and their parents. But there is no doubt that they need support. John Swinney has announced increased recruitment of teachers, and I think that's very welcome. But I do return to the question I asked him several months ago as to how many qualified retired teachers have been asked if they could help out in the short-term basis. I think a good number would be willing to assist, even if by tutoring from home, and it's surely important to address the high number of school absentees. And that also raises the issue of the very variable rates of online activity across our schools, whereby some are disadvantaged definitely by a lack of adequate digital infrastructure, something that can obviously impact much more heavily on those pupils in our poorer areas where schools have fewer resources than some of their counterparts, and those in the independent sector where obviously resources are much less of a problem and which have therefore supported more concentrated online learning, especially and including for those with additional support needs, pupils that we must never forget. But one of the main issues has to be the pursuit of more frequent and rigorous COVID testing, not only to help track the disease, but also to bring much needed confidence to our schools. Because I do understand and sympathise with those teachers who have chronic symptoms, who, however willing they may be, are simply not in a position to work safely in a school environment. And that raises questions about their income and, of course, longer term about their pension. So it was disappointing indeed to hear that in one council area, teachers have been instructed not to use the NHS app. That does not seem like best practice at all, nor is it the consistency of messaging, which is so crucial in order to ensure that there is public understanding and compliance with the necessary guidelines. Deputy Presiding Officer, 2020 has been a very grim experience for our schools. We should commend them for the way in which they have handled exceptionally difficult circumstances, but it is our duty to support them in whatever way we can, And that is why this debate is important, given the strength of feeling amongst parents and teachers that we still and can do more. So I'm very pleased to support the amendment in the name of Jamie Green.
Thank you. I now call on Monica Lennon to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to Ross Greer and the Scottish Greens for tabling the motion, which we support, and also put on record my deep gratitude to pupil staff and parents for all of their efforts. I declare an interest in this debate as the parent of a 14-year-old daughter. She's in S3 and she is enjoying being back at school, largely, I suspect, because she's getting to spend time with her friends. Young people have missed out on so much during the pandemic, and they have not escaped the pain caused by the virus, especially those who have been affected by close family bereavements. As the motion states, almost 30,000 pupils and more than 2,600 staff have been absent from school for COVID reasons. Those figures are 1 week old. But they are worrying. Absence rates are affecting areas with higher levels of deprivation more, and the impacts are uneven across Scotland. I'm just looking at the Public Health Scotland report published today, and the proportion of schools with pupils who have tested positive is highest in NHS Lanarkshire and the Greater Glasgow and Clyde areas. So we do need to better understand the link between self-isolation cases and deprivation, because in these areas, parents are going to be the least likely to afford private tuition to top up their children's education, and we're just going to see a further increase in the attainment gap. And as one teacher put to me, schools are open full-time, but it's not full-time education. So I think we have to be honest about the experience of young people in school. I can think of one young person who's not played her instrument in school since March. Others have not been able to fully participate in physical education. So what more can we do to make sure that young people get the full education experience? Ross Greer is absolutely right. Schools are struggling, and it's partly about resources. And I hear what Claire Adamson is saying about, well, we need the councils to interpret the guidance properly, but I think teachers and school staff are drowning in emails, instructions. We've had head teachers say in the media this week that they're up until 2 o'clock in the morning dealing with contact tracing issues. I've got constituents telling me that they're going through CCTV footage to work out who was standing next to who in the breakout areas. That is a very difficult task that we're given to school staff. And as Ian Gray has said, there is a lot of disruption already, so we need to be honest about that, because some young people have had to isolate on more than one occasion. I was reading last night that one school in Glenrothes currently has 400 pupils. That's half the school roll self-isolating, and a small number have COVID, as do a small number of teachers. But young people getting COVID is not just a number that we should just easily dismiss, because we don't know enough about the virus yet to fully understand the long-term health impacts for young people. Others have mentioned pregnancy, which I'm pleased about, because I've got one constituent in Lanarkshire just now who should be working at home, and she's getting very different advice from colleagues in other parts of the country. So we can't have a postcode lottery on health and safety, Cabinet Secretary. I have an interest as a Lanarkshire resident. We're going into level 4 on Friday. 11 local authorities in total are. So I do understand why the EIS is calling for blended or remote learning within those areas. Professor Leach told the COVID-19 committee this morning that it's impossible to know where people are catching COVID, and I understand why he's saying that. But we also keep hearing that it's not coming from schools. So again, I think it's fair to say that people are losing a bit of confidence. So we do need more transparency. We do need to see more data. And as the colleagues have said, we do need more resources and support for our teachers, our young people and their families. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I call Rona Mackay, who will be the last open debate speaker. Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Education Committee, I'm pleased to be able to speak in today's debate on such an important topic. Presiding Officer, there are points raised in the Green Motion that I wholeheartedly agree with. Education is the best place for teaching, and schools must be safe for pupils and teachers during this horrible pandemic. It's an absolute priority of this government. The absence rates of pupils and teachers should always be taken seriously, and disadvantaged areas are being harder hit which is sadly an all too familiar fact during this pandemic. It's absolutely unacceptable for any teacher to feel pressurised to return to school when notified by the app of a potential exposure risk. And it's absolutely unacceptable for clinically vulnerable teachers to be pressured into returning against specific advice of their GPs. However, I don't accept the premise that the government have not prepared adequately for the impact of COVID-19 in schools and that these issues have not been addressed. Presiding officer, more than 1,250 new teachers and support staff have been recruited as a result of £80 million of ring-fence support announced in June. Plans are underway to recruit another 200 teachers. An additional 155 support staff have also been hired, with a further 100 expected to follow. The Scottish Government's updated guidance on reducing the risks in schools have detailed information on all aspects of learning and working in schools during COVID-19. Crucially, arrangements are in place for staff concerned that they may have been at risk of infection to have informed access to testing through their employer, the local authority. Of course, staffing arrangements are a matter for local authorities and employers, as we've heard, as others have said, and they have been doing an excellent job coping with the challenges COVID-19 has brought this year. The guidance makes it clear that councils and schools should ensure that risk assessments are in place, including for those at the highest risk. So the decisions on where teachers and school staff who have previously been shielding are deployed are for individual schools and local authorities. As the guidance outlines, risk assessments should consider measures that can be taken to lower the risk of transmission among staff and pupils in all parts of the school. Among a raft of safety advice, the guidance makes clear that altering class sizes and composition is just one option that schools can consider to help maintain distancing. Presiding officer, my local authority area of East Dunbartonshire is, like many others in the west of Scotland, currently at level 4, and it's understandable that anxiety rates are high. As the First Minister outlined in her briefing today, the Chief Medical Officer will issue a letter similar to a footnote, which can be used in the few cases where, following updating of risk assessments and discussions with employers, it's not possible to make a workplace safe for staff. That will last for as long as the local area is under level 4 restrictions. Staff should use the period covered by the letter to discuss any concerns further with their employer, in this instance, a local authority or an occupational health advisor. And if following individualised risk assessments, action results in adequate protection in the workplace, they can continue to attend work. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, the Green motion is well intentioned, but I would ask that they take on board the measures that the Scottish Government has put in to keep pupils and staff safe. Our children and our amazing, hard-working teachers should have all the support they need during this extraordinary time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now move to closing speeches, and I call on Daniel Johnston to be followed by Jamie Halkett-Johnston.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As we face the crisis posed by us by the COVID pandemic, I think it is incumbent that we continue to question and challenge and continue to ask ourselves whether or not our approach is doing the very best that we can. And in some ways, I think that this debate was best, I think, contextualised by the combination of Ross Greer's opening comments and Jamie Green's, that we must, of course, thank teachers and all the other staff in our schools for the efforts that they've been undertaking, because it is absolutely admirable, and I think they do a credit to themselves and to our children. But we must also make sure that we are absolutely minimising the undoubted damage that is occurring to our children's education, and I think that is absolutely the frame of reference to this debate, and that is right and proper. There's a number of key themes I think touched on, and I'll try and cover them, although I don't have much time. First of all is the issue of transparency. And I, like Ian Gray, welcome the government's paper that it's released. I have had criticisms of the government's information in the past, but it's a well-referenced paper, and it is useful. But we must also take care, because the Lancet Journal article, which is the key article used by that paper to point to the lack of evidence for transmission, it itself admits there is a dearth of evidence, and much of the evidence it relies on looks at studies for MERS, SARS and flu. But nonetheless, I agree with the conclusions, but we must have that clarity, because as Monica Lennon and others pointed out, with rising absences from schools, there is a growing number of questions out there, and so that we must be calm and clear in the way that we're using this information if we are to maintain trust in the advice that's being provided, because that is absolutely key. But there are clearly questions around the mitigation steps that have been taken, and those have been well outlined by a number of people. I thought Patrick Harvey made a very useful contribution, I think questioning the consistency of the way the mitigation steps have been implemented. And I think, to Claire Adamson's point, she is right, in the sense that this is up to local authorities to implement this. But the key issue they face is that before this crisis, many schools lacked the support staff they needed to allow teachers to do anything other than teach. And if that was a problem before this crisis, it's absolutely one during the crisis, when we're asking our teachers not just to teach our pupils, but to keep them safe, to implement track and trace, as Ross Greer did, and the many other public safety measures. They simply need more staff, whether that's cleaners and classroom assistants, to enable them. And simply an increase of teachers, which there are questions whether they have arrived in the schools, that does not even bring us back to the point, the level of teachers we had in 2007. I think we have to ask and raise those questions. But we must also, I think, ensure that we have the investment in buildings and schools, the other mitigation steps that we've seen in other countries. Because ultimately, that should be our benchmark. Because there are other countries that have either through previous experience, such as SARS in Asia, or simply through better planning, have implemented more steps, more effective steps, such as the investment in ventilation in Germany that Ian Gray outlined. And we must challenge ourselves to do better and to meet the standards and the examples of the very best and leading countries. But ultimately, I think perhaps the most important issue is that of testing. And I think Liz Smith made that case very well. Until we reach a point where we have regular testing of asymptomatic individuals in schools, so we get an accurate picture of what's going on, we will continue to have the questions raised, not least because of the issues outlined by Ross Greer at the beginning, because of some of the questions and stories and issues that are raised. So I'd sum up by this, asking the government some simple questions. Can you improve the clarity and robustness of your scientific briefings? Can we continue to question and improve the mitigation steps as well as the investments in our building infrastructures? Can we have additional staff so that we can have smaller class sizes and more people to clean our school buildings? And can we roll out regular asymptomatic testing using lateral flow tests within our school estate? Because ultimately, the answers to those questions will be what enables people to have trust in the government's response. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Jamie Harker-Johnson to be followed by John Swinney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I welcome the recognition from around this chamber that this pandemic has been difficult for pupils and teachers across our schools. And it's right that we're able to show our gratitude for the work they have done in carrying on and often going the extra mile when faced with such tough circumstances. The main topic of the Greens' motion today has been on the safety of staff and pupils. Safety must always be paramount in our minds, and it should be consistent. Teachers in a vulnerable category should not be expected to take different risks depending on the council that employs them. They should not have their employer tell them to turn off their Test and Protect app when the First Minister tells them the opposite. In the last couple of weeks, we've heard encouraging news around the development of vaccines. However, as we've seen from the announcements yesterday in several local authorities in the Central Belt, we're a long way from having this pandemic under control. And one issue I'd like to highlight is around mental health. This period will likely have a continuing impact on pupils and staff alike, and that the consequences for mental health must be given equal importance as the impact of the virus, on physical health. But it is clear there's also a broad frustration around the transparency and clarity in the guidance and direction from the Scottish Government. Ministers have continued to flirt with the idea of school closures despite the guidance set down only a few short weeks ago, envisaging that schools in Tier 4 areas would remain open with additional safety measures. I believe, as I've argued in this chamber, that we must work hard to keep schools safely open as far as possible. If there is a threat to that, then parents and teachers should be aware of how any decision will be made, rather than being left to rely on the judgment of the First Minister or Education Secretary. We know all too well that remote learning did not work effectively, and I've seen little evidence to suggest that it will improve if attempted for a second time. When I questioned ministers on making IT equipment available to pupils who needed it, it was repeatedly kicked down the line until schools had returned. And even now, it remains far from clear how this equipment has been allocated and how many pupils will be able to access blended
or remote learning approach. We also saw Education Scotland, which could have coordinated and driven forward remote learning, take a backseat. Then on return to schools, the government was again painfully slow to respond when a need for additional teachers and support staff became obvious. Teachers entering the profession were left to question whether they would find employment, despite ministers' assurances. And almost inevitably, those who suffered most from all these cases were the pupils from the most deprived backgrounds. We've heard many positive contributions from around the chamber today, and I welcome the Greens' approach to this debate. Obviously, I've not got a huge amount of time, so I'm going to focus on two of my colleagues. My colleague Jamie Green highlighted particularly the variable engagement with and by pupils across the country while schools were closed. It was clear and apparent to us all that there were good initiatives offered for some, but next to no education offered for others during that time. Liz Smith remarked on schools' broader role and importance to social well-being, the structure they provide for many of the people who attend them, and the role of testing in not only tracking the disease, but restoring confidence that the government is listening and addressing risks within schools. Presiding officer, we're at a crucial time in the course of the pandemic. As the Greens' motion recognises, education is best delivered in the classroom. But to continue to deliver that safely will require the sort of direction, support and leadership that has been so sadly lacking from central government since March.
Thank you. I call on John Swinney to be followed by Ross Greer.
President Officer, I agree with a lot of what's been discussed in this debate, and I think Mr Greer characterised it fairly, where he said that there isn't actually an awful lot of difference or debate between individual political parties, but you know, we're in one of those opposition day afternoons. Ian Gray raised the point that the desirability of having schools open is not being debated this afternoon. And I take that emphatic message from Parliament this afternoon that Parliament wants schools to remain open and they want schooling to be delivered full time. So I take that very seriously and I will make sure I do everything in my power to make sure that is the case, representing what Parliament wants to see happen. Daniel Johnson raised the issue of the need to continue to challenge mitigations, and I would respectfully say to Daniel Johnson that's precisely what the changes to guidance have been all about. We've not stood still with the August guidance. We've enhanced it in two separate occasions to strengthen it, and we'll continue to do that based on the clinical evidence that we are providing. Patrick Harvey and Claire Adamson and Rhona Mackay all touched on the issue about staff being required to participate in schooling when they had worries about their health. And there are two key points about this. First of all, in the absence of the point, in contrast to the point made by Mr. Halcrow-Johnson, the guidance is crystal clear on this point, that local authority employers must ensure that clinical advice is taken into account when agreeing appropriate mitigations with employees. There's no debate about that. That should be followed. But it comes down to the point that Claire Adamson raised. Local authorities have a duty of care to their employees to decide exactly how an individual should be handled. And in that circumstance, it is important that clinical input is taken into account. I'll give way to Mr. Johnson.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for giving me. Would he also acknowledge that the ability to implement these measures very much comes down to having enough resources in the schools to do it so that teachers are freed up from teaching?
I don't think that is a fair point, because if a member of staff is judged clinically not to be fit to be at school, they shouldn't be at school, and there should be no debate about it. And local authorities should backfill from other sources of supply lists or other resources that are available to do so. Mr. Rowley made a question to the First Minister yesterday about a Unison survey about a lack of supplementary cleaning in schools, and I'm bewildered by that point, because the government has put in place £50 million of additional resources to pay for exactly the point that Mr. Rowley was raising in his fair question to the First Minister yesterday. And it's important that we actually implement the details in the guidance to make sure schools are properly and fully cleaned. Liz Smith raised the issue that it's important that we take forward the issues of education because of the strength of parental views on this question, and I think that's absolutely right. The Connect research survey published yesterday shows that 70% of parents are happy with the return to school and nursery. That didn't exactly feel like the feedback I was getting from the points being represented by members of Parliament this afternoon. Now, Jamie Green raised the issue about tutoring and mentoring, and I just wonder if Mr Green and Mr Halcrow-Johnson talked about the fact that Education Scotland has apparently not been coordinating anything. If both of them would like to look at the Twitter feed for the eScall, they will find on offer for next week Studies Support Live webinar licence for National 5 Maths, Advanced Higher English, Higher Human Biology, Higher Business Management, National 5 Physics, Advanced Higher Physics, Higher Physics, National 5 Computing Science. Of course I'll give way, yes.
Joanne Lamond.
Yeah, just take you away from Twitter for once. My concern is about disadvantaged young people who are not engaging with education at all. What work has been done to reach out into these families who didn't engage during lockdown, who disproportionately will not have come back, and should there be blended learning, will not be able to take advantage of that? What work has been done to direct resources into those communities which are much needed?
Well, I don't think Joanne Lamont's in any position to tell me to spend less time on Twitter, given what she spends her time doing on Twitter. But aside from that little jocular, friendly remark, Joanne Lamont's absolutely right that schools being back is crucial to reaching those families and engaging them. And actually, over the summer, the period of lockdown, schools did a phenomenal job in reaching young people in disadvantaged circumstances to try to ensure that they were well supported. So, Presiding Officer, the Government is wholly committed to ensuring that we do all that we can to work with local... And actually, I think local authorities have worked immensely hard. They've worked with us on the guidance. It's been a joint venture, as Claire Adamson set out, a joint venture to produce this guidance. It has to be applied in full. It will be applied in full. Interestingly, the Health and Safety Executive, who looked at the safety of school staff, gave a very positive assessment about the way in which the guidance had been applied at local level within schools. We should take confidence and encouragement from that independent assessment of the performance of schools, give thanks to our teachers. I'd point out that my amendment actually does thank teachers, and I would encourage members not to vote against my amendment because they're voting against words thanking teachers for their contributions to enable us to ensure that we build, so that we build on the achievements that have been made and ensure that we keep our schools safe and we deliver education for children and young people the length and breadth of our country.
Thank you, and I call on Ross Greer to wind up and close the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's good to hear support from across the Chamber for the proposals put forward in the motion today, as well as the amendments in the name of Ian Gray and Jamie Green. Just to reflect on a couple of the points that were raised in the debate, Jamie Green and Claire Adamson both addressed the issue of Council's responsibility in this, just coming at it from completely opposite directions. And all I would say to Claire Adamson and to the Government is that, yes, the local authorities may be the employer, but teachers' terms and conditions are agreed on a tripartite basis, including the Scottish Government, and it is ultimately the Government's responsibility when it comes to matters of public health. This is not an issue that can simply be passed over to local authorities and any blame assigned to them where there's an issue. Yes.
John Swinney.
I hear what Mr. Greer is saying, but the point I'm making is that the guidance is crystal clear that where there is clinical information, that must be taken into account in the risk assessment of an individual member of staff. Now, I am not empowered to take that decision because I'm not the employer of a single teacher in the country. That is the responsibility of local authorities.
Ross Greer.
The Cabinet Secretary is right to say that he cannot make an intervention in the case of individual staff where it is an issue with their employer. The Government does have overall enforcement powers when it comes to issues of public health, and that's the issue that is being raised by the opposition here. It's an issue that I'm going to come back to in a moment, but I do want the Cabinet Secretary to bear that in mind. He made some remarks about the Health and Safety Executive, but what he is being told by Parliament today is something quite different, and we are being told that by teachers, by support staff, by pupils and parents. It is a point the Government needs to take on board. Ian Gray mentioned the need for updated guidance and advice to be published on a regular basis to give staff, pupils and everyone else involved confidence in the system. That is absolutely key here, particularly when we raise issues like, as Jamie Halcrow-Johnson did, about the mental health impact of this. There is a huge amount of anxiety, even amongst those who are not clinically vulnerable. On Ian Gray's amendment in regards to ventilation, I would say to the Government that there was an article in the English language version of the Spanish LP newspaper that's been cited regularly by government ministers, by Scottish Government health officials, that demonstrates the issue of a lack of ventilation in a classroom and how it aids transmission of the virus. So I would hope that the Government can bring themselves to support the Labour amendment today. On the issues that were raised around additional cleaning staff, I think by Ian Gray, the Cabinet Secretary has addressed it in relation to Alec Rowley's FMQ. Yes, additional money has been allocated for cleaning staff, but it clearly doesn't go far enough, and there's an issue with where it is being deployed. I was contacted by the head of an early years centre yesterday, who informed me that additional cleaning staff in her school were deployed to all the primary school classrooms, and she, as well as taking on frontline delivery responsibilities because she's got staff self-isolating, as well as taking on test and protect responsibilities, is now also the person primarily responsible for cleaning her nursery every single day. And we are all well aware of the issues in nursery around bodily fluids being more of an issue than in primary school classrooms. That is a huge burden. Patrick Harvey raised issues specifically in relation to Glasgow and comments by council staff there that teachers can't possibly teach from home. All I would suggest is, and I'm not saying that this is a simple solution, but I would point out that with substantial numbers of young people in areas like Glasgow that are in level four now having to learn remotely because they themselves are shielding, can the shielding staff not be given the responsibility of working with them on a remote learning basis? Would that not make sense to at least try and explore that option, something that I don't believe a number of councils have explored? Both Liz Smith and Daniel Johnson made the point around testing bringing confidence. We know that testing, we know that mass regular testing is key to suppressing the virus, but it is also key to giving people the confidence to actually go to work believing that they are safe. Again, the mental health issues that Jamie Halcrow Johnson raised are relevant here. The Education Committee of this Parliament has taken evidence repeatedly over the last few years on the mental health strain on teachers. 40% of teachers in Scotland before this pandemic were considering leaving the profession. What do we think the impact of this is going to be on them now? We are talking about vulnerable, extremely vulnerable staff members in some cases, which is why I come back to this point around enforcement. It's fair for the government to say if they believe the guidance is strong enough that that's the case. I would dispute that. Teachers, union officials, etc., I've spoken to, would dispute that. It is too vague in key areas. But if the guidance is strong enough, it becomes an issue of enforcement, and the government cannot avoid its responsibility in relation to enforcement. I want to round off this debate, though, by just bringing up the cases of two vulnerable members of staff who got in touch with me from schools. One was a primary teacher who taught the youngest level of primary school children and requested that from August, in line with guidance, she be given an older class, primary six or seven, because it would be easier to maintain some level of social distancing. That request, in line with guidance, was rejected. She subsequently, at 7 or 8 months pregnant, I believe, tested positive after a number of pupils in her class displayed symptoms. The second case, which I found extremely distressing, is of a teacher who lost a child during a previous pregnancy and whose current pregnancy is considered high risk, but who's also had requests to work from home, supported by all her doctors, occupational health professionals, etc., rejected out of hand by her employer. This simply isn't good enough, and these are not isolated incidents. This is happening across the country. We all want our young people's education to suffer as little as possible during this pandemic. But we all want pupils and staff to be safe, and we all acknowledge that that is really quite hard to achieve right now. The proposals laid out today, which I believe will achieve the support of Parliament, get us somewhat closer to being able to achieve that. It's clear that there's broad agreement in Parliament as to how we can do this. So I'm going to close by asking the government to take that on board and deliver the protection that teachers, school support staff, and pupils simply deserve.
Thank you very much. That concludes the debate on safe schools. We will move on in a moment to the next item of business. May I remind members to observe social distancing requirements in the chamber, in particular when leaving or entering the chamber. We'll move on in a moment to the next item of business.